So I know a lot of you have been here for the last couple weeks. If you haven't been and you see this white card and pen on the papers or on your chair, that's not a paper, that's your chair, just hold tight. It'll all make sense here in a little bit, so hang out with me. We've been in the middle of this reset series, and this is the end of that reset series. And again, I want to recap. This series was kind of born out of my hot mess. I don't want to even blame it on anybody other than myself. My hot mess that I was going through back in October and November of things that was going on between Jamie and I and our marriage that we were working on, things that I was as a dad that I was working on, but most importantly, things that I was working on as a man of God, like follower, as a Christ follower, things that I was trying to be better at. And I sat there, and as I started talking to more and more people, realized that I wasn't the only one kind of going through that. So we, as you know, as I kind of talked this over with the church board here, and we kind of discussed, and I went forward with this, and I'm excited about this. And I know I say that all the time. I get excited about all the series, right? Like the next one about Daniel that we're starting in 2 weeks, I'm excited about that. I'm excited to next week have a week where our family's gonna go enjoy the most magical place in the world, and because everybody knows I love crowds and theme parks, so. But I like being warm, so I'll be in Florida and watching my wife and kids ride, because that Dumbo ride's really scary, and I don't get on it. The Goofy ride, whatever one. So if you'll notice the pictures, if you follow us, you'll see pictures of Jamie and the kids and all the kid rides, and me in the background shaking like I think we're all going to die. I cry. Goofy gets me every time. But right, like we're in the middle of that. I'm excited about the seasons. I'm excited about the changes. I'm excited about the things that God is doing in this church. But I'm excited because we're in that spot where we're all growing and we're being honest with each other and we're saying, what is it that I need, God? What is it that I have? What is it that you have for us? So years ago, I went on a January trip for college credit to Kenya. I hate flying. I don't know why I'm putting myself through this. So get on a plane for 20-some hours and fly to Africa. But it was always my dream. And that entire trip was phenomenal. I loved everything. Other than the food poisoning I got. But the last day there, they kind of, as our reward, they took us to this restaurant called Carnivore. It was phenomenal. Imagine being, you know, for the last 4 weeks, I was living off of rice and, like, stuff that I couldn't eat. And then I get to this place, and this Carnivore restaurant, they come around to your table, and they have this long steak that they set there, and they chop off a chunk of meat. So literally, like, meat sweats 101, like, everything you can eat, like, I mean, zebra, gazelle, alligator, everything you could possibly want. And the entire trip was made up of 15 of us. 13 of them were girls, and then me and one other guy. So we're like loving this. We're there, like, do you have a side salad with this? And we're like, no, give me more zebra, give me more gazelle. Like, just going. And the waiter told us at the very beginning of this, you'll see that little flag, we're going to keep bringing you meat until you put the flag down. So my friend Tim and I were like, yeah, challenge accepted. We're going to eat this place out, right? Like we will win this battle. Mind you, I was still a week after having food poisoning, but I was going to win that battle. And I sat there and I kept going, we can do this. And you have like 18 different dipping sauces, all this different stuff. And finally, I just sat there and I grabbed that flag and I just like threw it down. I was like, no more. I can't have another bite of any animal, anything to eat, right? Like, just absolutely, it was beyond everything. But it was that call that it was like, I can do this. I can battle through. I can out-eat a restaurant that's known for giving you as much meat as you possibly can. I can do that. But it came to that point where I just put the flag down. And the waiter, this guy, this Kenyan, he comes up and he goes, nobody ever wins. And he looks at me and I was like, right? Like, that's our faith story, right? Like, we try to battle this out. We try to do this, and we try to go, I can do this on my own. I can do this. And God's going, no, it's time to reset. It's time to draw back to you. It's time to draw back to me. God's saying, it's time to reach out. It's time to reset your faith. So many of you have, in conversations, said, I know I need to reset. I know I need this, but I just don't know how. So the old teacher in me went with the old who, what, when, where, why, and how. Like, right? Like, going through it. Like, so, very simply, who? God wants a personal relationship with you. You have to understand that God wants a relationship with you individually. Yes, God loves all of us. God But it's that individual relationship. The relationship's the important part. What God calls us to repent, because God knows that we've fallen. God knows that we've made mistakes. God calls us to repent, to come back to come back to Him. When are we supposed to do it? It's when those convictions hit, right? Like, it's when we do something, when we say something to our wife, when we say something to our kids, when we say something to a friend, when we do something, and the conviction hits, where the Holy Spirit just kind of nudges you and goes, "Hey, that was not cool. That was not cool. You shouldn't have done that." That's when we repent. That's when we talk to God and say, "I'm sorry that I messed up." Where? It can be anywhere. This is one of my biggest pet peeves with people that are like, "Oh, it has to be done at church. It has to be done here. It has to be done." No, it does not matter. God does not ever say it. You must do this at a certain location, standing on one foot with one finger. No, God, it doesn't matter where. You can do it anytime. And why? Is again because the sin that creates a gap between us and God. It creates a relationship. When I back up to where things were going on between Jamie and I and the kids and I in different situations, there was gap between us. There was a separation because we were going through life going check mark, busy, do this. And we had created a gap between us and our marriage. And that had to be fixed. And that's the same thing with God. We get in this spot where we sin, we fall short, we do whatever, we let the things in our heart become more important than God. It creates that gap. And we have to understand that sin. And how? It's supposed to be sincere. Right? Like you're so broken, it's supposed to be sincere. It's to not look back. It's to not be... And some of that time, you know, like, there's times where I've literally just fallen on my knees and said, "God, I can't do this anymore." And that was sincere. But there's also moments that I just sit there and I'm like driving in my car going, "God, I can't do this anymore." At that moment, I needed to be on my knees. At that moment, I needed to be driving my car. It didn't matter how I reached out to God, but I just said, "I need a reset. I need this moment. I need this. I need you, more of you, God, and less of myself, less of this world." So going through all of this stuff, like, in understanding how we need that separation, we need to have a breaking moment. And as a youth pastor, you try to think of all these like great ideas, and you go through that, and you have all these like retreat, we're going to have a big whatever moment at the end of the retreat, or at the end of mission trip, we're going to have a moment where these kids come back changed, and we work on something, and that's so important. And so now that I'm into this senior pastor role, I don't know what that even means, but right, like, now that I'm in this moment, it's like I can't do those youth ministry things. And so I had all these ideas, and I sat there and I was like, "Okay, I can't do that because that's too youth pastorish. I can't do that because that's too youth pastorish." And like, I tried to go through all this different stuff. And literally this week, God, like, one of those moments where God just hit me in the head. And I promise you, I mean, for nothing else, I had to read the Bible completely beginning to end for college. But I've read the Bible many times over, and I've never, ever, ever came across this until this week. And I went, "Okay, I get it, God." And it's Acts 19, 18, and 19. 18 through 20, sorry. Also, many of those who were now believers came, confessing and divulging their practices. A number of those who had practiced magical arts brought their books together and burned them in the sight of all. And they counted the value of them and found out it came to 50,000 pieces of silver. Hold on one quick second. So this is, Acts is the early church. This is like, right after Jesus, you know, he goes back to heaven, all this. This is the early church in that infancy. And you have to understand, the beginning part is right there, where it says, also many of those who are now believers came. So they were practicing magical arts. They were doing things that weren't godly, right? They were doing things that weren't Christian, but yet they were starting to understand Christianity. They were young in their faith. They were in those infant stages of growing and still doing things of the world, but didn't understand, but had a change and had a transformation, said, "I want to be like you, God. I want to be Christian. I want to follow you," but there's still things of the world, right? So they come before that, and they say, they brought their magical art. So we'll say, whatever it is that's creating that gap between you and God, that's what they brought. And they brought this, and these magical art books, and they burned them for all the sight, and it came to 50,000 pieces of silver. I want you to understand something. Right? Like, in that day, one piece of silver was one day's wage. So 50,000 pieces of silver. So that was 50,000 days of work. Imagine that, right? 50,000 days of work. And they literally said, this is the thing that's separating me from God. This is the thing that's separating. This is the thing. And if you really want like a mind-blowing moment here, I looked it up and I told Greg Wilson earlier this week, and I re-looked it up to update my stats. This actually comes to $5.5 million in today's standards that they literally burned because it was stopping them from worshiping God. It was getting in their way. These guys came with $5.5 million and said, I don't care. I want to follow God more. I would have a hard time doing that with $5. $5.5 million. So it continues on. So the word of the Lord continued to increase and prevail mightily. They were willing to burn. They were willing to sacrifice. They were willing to completely get rid of the thing that was causing them separation from God. And God, the Lord, continued to increase and prevail mightily. They were willing to do that. Are we willing to do that? Are we willing to sacrifice? James 4:8, it's a great verse. It talks about, draw near to God and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands and you sinners and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Right? Right? Like James is talking here going, cleanse your heart, do this. Like he's reaching out to you. God wants you to be in a relationship with him. God so badly wants that for you. There's a story that was shared in 1519. Hernan Cortez, which was an explorer, right? Like he went, and you may have heard this story before, he, with all of his soldiers, got them all off the boat. And what did he do to the boat? He burned the ship. He burned all of the boats because he needed them to know, we are either going to take this land, there is no retreating. We have no choice but to take this land. There is no retreating. There is no going back. Those soldiers, I mean, right? Like, we can't get back on the ship and retreat. We have to go forward. We have to. And so you'll hear people like, this is the burn the ships moment. This is the moment that it really meant something to me. So maybe you're in the, like Jamie prayed, maybe you're in the middle of this like resetting and confused and going, God, I just don't get it. So anybody that has been through my youth group has heard this, and you've probably heard this because I've used it a couple different times. And if you haven't, here's your aha moment that I had years ago that a couple people are even looking like laughing because they know that I use this moment when I talk to kids, when I talk to youth, when I speak at camps, when I, even for myself, more than anything else, when for myself, I use this analogy of the three stools. And that the idea that there's three stools of life that you can be in. The first is the first stool that you can sit in is that's when you just don't know God, you don't have a relationship with him, you don't understand, you have no concept of what it is to be a Christian. The third stool is the fact of when you have a relationship with God, when you're on fire, when things are going right, when you're like, hey, I'm in the Word, yeah, little things are going to come up, but I'm doing well. And that middle stool is that point where you just are in like lukewarm la-la land, whatever you want to call it. And those are the moments, right? Like you get up and you move from those different stools. Like all of us started in this world because of a sinful world. We started in a spot where we didn't know what it was like to have a faith or to be in a relationship with Jesus. And then coming to church, obviously stuff like this, at some point most of us transition to that third stool, that point of where we're like, hey, yes, I believe in God. I believe in Jesus. Like I've accepted him. Like this, whatever word terminology you want to use, I'm here, I'm set. But then something happens where we go, oh, you know, whatever comes in our way, gets in our way. And at different points in my life, I've shared that. Like, I've shared those moments where I'm like, yeah, like, hey, I'm doing this. Like, and I, this is great. This is a great spot to be. And I went, you know what? This isn't fair. Or something got in the way. Like, something came up that just really shook me. And I was sharing in that same conversation of different things where I started to battle in my early 20s with life's not fair. Because everybody else got this, everybody else got this. So I started to didn't even realize that I'd shifted myself back off a stool. And like, I was in a spot where I wasn't happy. And so we use that analogy with youth. I've used that analogy in my own life. I've used that analogy with conversation of some of my youth that are now moved on and in their 20s and whatever. And they'll still like touch base with me and be like, hey, John, can we talk? And I got a text about a month ago from one of the guys that was in my youth group. And he's like, I don't like being in the middle stool anymore. That was his text. And I was like, oh, that's kind of a fun, you know, like now I know where you are. I know how to relate this, right? Like, and I said, I get that. And how do we take that? And it comes back to that entire thing of burning the ships. It comes back to that entire thing of what is it that we need to burn? What is getting in our way of getting up and saying, hey, I fell short. I've fallen into that complacency, fallen into that lukewarmness, and I'm trying to reset, but I keep getting in the way. Yesterday morning, we woke up to a colder house than normal, and I woke up to Jamie going, is there a reason that I've had the shower on for 10 minutes and it's cold water? Right? Like, and so we have this dual boiler system in our house, and I have no idea how it works. I could do the old stuff, but I have no idea how a dual boiler works. And so we went to basketball games, and I called the guy that put it in and waited and got back. And finally he called me, and he's like, so what's the error codes? What's going on? I said, that, he goes, have you reset it? I said, yes, I've reset the thing 18 times. Like, right, I've turned off, wait 5 seconds, turned it back on. Turned it off, wait 5 seconds, like, right? Like, I hit the reset button. What do I do now? And we go through, and in the error code, he's like, he looks at me, he goes, John, I told you this was going to happen. I went, what? He goes, when I put that in, I told you this was going to happen. I warned you. And I'm like, okay, what's going on? He goes, you have this system and wait. Some of you are like, hey, yeah, this is fun. But others, you're like, shut up, John. Like, the glycol goes through the heating in the floor. And after so long, air bubbles will pop up. And you're going to be low on pressure. And you're going to have to add more glycol or water. And if you're not feeding the system, you're going to run out of an ability to heat your house and have hot water. And I'm like, you're right. I've hit reset 18 times and nothing happened, but I actually had to physically do something and I added a little bit more, and sure enough, we had warm showers this morning. It was awesome, and we had heat in our house. It was awesome. It was warm and fuzzy, and right? Like, you had to do something. I had to do something. I couldn't just hit reset. I had to make an active change. So my question to you at the end of this series is, what is it that you need to burn? What is getting in your way? What is stopping you? Like, right? Like, it feels like a cheesy youth group thing, but it's true. Like, what is it that is that moment of no return? What is it that has caught you so far? Excuse me. Is it an action? Is it an opportunity? Is it something that you just can't get over? Is it an incident? Something that happened in your past that you're embarrassed by, that you've held on to? Said, God can't love me. You've lived in shame because of that incident. You lived in shame because of that accident. God doesn't call us to live in shame. Walking with God is not about shame. The conviction helps direct us, but it's not about shame. Or is it an attitude? What is it that's getting in your way of truly being the Christ follower, truly diving fully in with this? What is it that you're just like, you know what, I've reset this before and I can't do it anymore? So it comes to these cards. We've been talking about these cards, and different ones have been prayer this week. If you want to grab an extra to take home, that's fine. But this week we're going to do something special, that you have a card and we left pens because I want you to write on that card, what is it that your burn the ship moment? What is it that is drawing you where it's just you can't live the life that you know you should? Is it depression that you're in? Anxiety? Is it something in your marriage? Like, there is nothing that you can face in this world that we can't find a way out of with God's help. So what is your burn the ships moment? What is it I have to leave behind that there's no going back? So we're going to have those, and in a little bit, I'm going to ask that you just drop that in the bucket up here and leave it behind. And it's a cheesy symbol, but it's just like they did in Acts, right? Like, these books are getting in the way of me following God. I can't have them in my life anymore. And I went through this entire thing, and I was sharing that with somebody this morning, like, right? Like, there's youth pastors that do stats and all this stuff, and they're like, oh, you realize doing something like this is only going to really affect so much of your church. And I went, I don't care. If one of you changes and walks out of here today, free from what's holding you down, then I'm going to be happy. Because something's getting in the way of having you be the Christ follower that you know you can be. There's something that's holding you back, and it's your burn the ship moment. It can be something big or small. We're going to do that during our walkout song. And I've asked a couple of you to come help with communion. And while I pray, I ask that you guys will come up. And I thought this was fitting. And Jamie put this so beautifully that I couldn't put this together. You're going to leave this in the bucket here, your burn the ship moment. And after that, we're going to have two stations of communion. And if you're gluten-free, there's a couple of these fancy, I use fancy, Abby, just for you. Fancy gluten-free cups with the wafer on top. We have that option for you too. But this is the moment that God's calling you to. This is the moment that, hey, you can be changed, you can be better. That this is the moment that you get free of what is holding you down. And I encourage you, when you drop that in, don't look back, right? Like leave it here. Leave that here and know that God has taken it away, and now you're taking communion and filling yourself back up. You fill that void with God, with Jesus. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, be with us today. I pray for each and every person that's in this room that just is struggling with something that is beyond anything that they can even fathom, that they can't see, that may be too embarrassing to even write on the card. God, I've had moments like that in situations like that that I went, I want to write this down, God, but it's too big. If anybody saw what was on my card, God, I couldn't look them in the eye ever again. Like, God, this is too much. And God, I know you're right there going, no, nothing is too big. Nothing is too powerful. Nothing is too strong that can't be faced by God. Like, God, you are bigger than each and everything that we can even imagine. And God, I just ask that you will take those moments away from us, take those things away from us, those opportunities, take those situations, those incidents, those sins that we drop and we leave behind, God. Be with us as we continue to draw closer to you in all that we say and all that we do. It's in your name. Amen.